What tutoring technology is available? How can tutors engage reluctant readers? For the answers to these and other questions, please join us for segment 4 of the Reading Rockets webcast, Talking Tutoring.
Funding for the Reading Rockets webcast series is provided by the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs.
Hi, I'm Delia Pompa. Welcome to the Reading Rockets webcast, Talking Tutoring. In previous segments, we've discussed the impact of tutoring and what to look for in a good tutoring program. Now it's time to hear what's on our audience's mind. Welcome, Dr. Invernizzi, Ms. Preston, Ms. Hoover, glad to have you back. If you're ready, let's dive right into the first question.
Hi. What's your opinion of online tutoring and what other technologies are good for providing extra help?
Take it, anyone.
Well, I think that online tutoring can oftentimes help to fix a particular spot that a child is having difficulty with. It is probably not going to be adequate if a child is really having trouble with reading at a more basic level. If it's just, you know, a small problem with one particular vowel, say, those exercises might be very engaging to the child, but it certainly can't replace an individual person looking at the diagnostic and assessment work and then planning a program specifically for that child.
Others? Thank you. Let's take an email question now. This one comes from Sarah in Massachusetts, and Sarah asks, has No Child Left Behind had any impact on the number and quality of tutoring programs available? Carol, what are your thoughts on this?
Certainly, No Child Left Behind has created a funding stream called Supplemental Educational Services, and that's providing a voucher, essentially, to parents of low-income children that can be worth up to $2,000. And so, in that case, parents get to choose among a range of state-approved providers. What's happened is many new providers have sprung up in the last 3 or 4 years. They offer very different programs. Some programs provide as little as 10 hours of tutoring for that $2,000 voucher. Others, like Bell, will provide well in excess of 100 hours. So I think that parents have a wide range of solutions. They need to look at things like how many hours, class size, qualifications of the tutors, curriculum, and most importantly, outcomes. Every really good provider will have outcomes to share, and if you don't see those outcomes, then I would keep looking.
Great, thank you. We have another question here in studio.
Yes. Hello. Can parents and grandparents make good volunteer tutors, and what other sources are available to help us build a volunteer tutoring program?
Take that one.
Go ahead.
You know, it's a great question, and we are at such a phenomenal point in our nation's history. There is such focus now on college students volunteering, but also baby boomers. We have something in excess of 5 million baby boomers retiring every year. And when you ask them what they want to do, they want to do something with children and education. And so Marcia mentioned there's a group called Experience Corps that is recruiting seniors to come and provide great tutoring, and I would go check out their website.
Thanks very much. We're going to go back to email now, and we have one from Katie in Chicago who's asking, how long should extra tutoring last? All the way through high school? A grading period? I actually asked this question during a break. Marcia, what did you say?
Well, a small percentage of students will need tutoring and certainly support throughout their schooling. But it's certainly not the 20% that are currently designated as learning disabled in our nation's schools right now. That percentage can be lowered dramatically by providing early intervention right from the get-go. Starting with students as soon as they walk into kindergarten, perhaps providing additional instruction to make up for lost opportunities or lack of experiences. First, perhaps in small groups, and if needed, then moving to more intensive one-on-one tutoring. But the research is suggesting that the proportion of students who will need continued support for over the long haul is under 3%. So certainly not 20%.
Carol, did you want to add anything to that?
No, I think that Marcia said it well. I mean, what we do is we do pre and post tests of students every period that they work with us. So it could be during the school year, it could be summer. Some people close that achievement gap within the one summer that we work together. Others, it takes more than two or three sessions. Mm-hmm. But typically we see that the more they get involved, the more they want to keep coming back, the greater the gains.
Great. Mm-hmm.
And I've also observed that there are some tutoring programs that give you a package sort of deal, that you sign up for 20 lessons, whether you know whether you're going to need it or not. And I think if you're going to go with that kind of a program, then you've got to be doubly careful to see the assessments and be sure that you're getting what you need. You may need less, you may need more, so trying to prepay or pre-decide how long you need tutoring could be a mistake.
That's a good thing to watch out for.
Yes.
Let's go back to our audience for another question.
Hello. Do you have any guidance on how to help older kids serve as mentors for younger, struggling readers?
I'll take that one. First of all, the same qualifications have to apply. They have to be committed, they have to enjoy working with children, they have to love reading. Those three things are absolutely essential. And the committed part is even harder to get with older, but still adolescent. Learners, but certainly if you support them in the way that, for example, we in Book Buddies, we've supported our volunteer students, tutors, by training them, providing a consistent, structured lesson plan, organizing the materials ahead of time for them, showing them how to do each component of the lesson plan, being there to model the behaviors, demonstrate each part, and observing them as they do it to provide immediate feedback. Rather than let problems develop or go astray, I think that high school students could make effective tutors of younger children. That was your question, right?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
I also would like to add that one of the things we find is really an important part of our reading lessons is to end a lesson with the tutor reading aloud to the student in order to promote a love of reading. Exactly. And the written text. Mm-hmm. When children are struggling to do it themselves. And I think having teens, high school students read aloud to their student would be a wonderful part of the program.
Yeah. Thank you. And younger students really do love working with teenagers. So they have an advantage in that way. So they can be great role models.
Yeah. We're going to go back to the email bag now. Thanks for those answers. And this is a question from Karen in Virginia, who's asking if tutoring is an option for kids in children in kindergarten, and if so, what should it look like? Marcia?
I would certainly say it is an option for a child in kindergarten if they already are exhibiting signs that learning to read is going to be difficult for them. Some things to keep in mind with a child as young as 5 or younger are that the sessions should be short and they should be frequent. A young child needs more sessions per week than an older student, and one must pay close attention to their attention span and vary the activities throughout that time. Maybe a half an hour would be enough, but they may need to do 3, 4, 5 different activities over that time. It's important that the lessons be very positive and encouraging so that they are set up to be successful in school.
Great, thank you.
I agree.
Thank you. Did you want to add something?
I was just going to say that I agree with everything Ann said, that's so important for young students to be engaged and to have a variety of activities and in game-like formats. But going back to the idea of universal literacy screening, we know at the very beginning of kindergarten, children who have lacked the foundational emergent literacy skills coming into kindergarten, and we can and should be working with them either in small group formats or in one-on-one, perhaps starting out in small groups and then moving to the one-on-one. But as Ann said, more frequently, more varied, game-like, certainly developmentally appropriate. But
looks a lot like play, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Back to the audience.
What role should principals play in providing tutoring options in their schools or communities?
I think principals play a very critical role. Principals really are the gateway to that school. So many providers will want to serve a particular community or a particular school community, and if we can't get to the principal, it's almost impossible to set up a program. We like the fact that at Bell we have programs in the schools so that students don't sort of disappear on their way out and on their way home. But having that principal be supportive to the program, encouraging children to participate, encouraging their parents to sign up, not looking at tutoring as a sign of failure, but rather tutoring as a sign of giving these children every possible opportunity that we can. We like to use the term these days of extended learning or expanded learning, not tutoring as something that is a sign that your child is a failure, but that we're just giving you even more opportunity to grow and be everything you can be.
Thanks.
I'd like to add one thing to that. I think it's very educational for a principal to tutor themselves, at least for 1 year. They would learn a lot.
We'll send that message. Again, we have a question from the audience.
If a teacher wanted to start a tutoring program for ELL students, what would be the first steps that teacher would take?
Marcia?
I think that collaboration is really key. If a teacher's wanting to start an intervention for their ELL students, first you have to find out, well, what are the languages, what are the culture, and so forth. But here, collaboration is so important because if the teacher who is providing the language instruction, the teacher who is providing the literacy instruction, and the teacher who is providing the content instruction all collaborate, then the child's exposure to these concepts and vocabulary terms will be more frequent, and this collaboration will result in greater exposure to the language, literacy, and content that you're trying to impart. So I would say that would be the first step, is get with all the other educators who are involved in teaching the ELL students and collaborating on what that would look like.
Did you want to add something, Carol?
No, I think that really covers it. I would also say don't leave out the parents. Mm-hmm. Just because the parents may not have English as their primary language doesn't mean that they don't need to be involved and supportive. So a child can go home and read to his or her parents. Mm-hmm. A parent can check homework even if they're not in a position to help with homework, because research has proven that if parents are engaged, supportive of their children, that goes a long way to help those children be successful in school.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. You all have prompted lots of questions. We have another one.
How can a tutor engage a child whose academic difficulties have made her a reluctant reader?
Anne, can you take that one?
Well, yes. I think that one of the things that we emphasize with our tutors is that their first job is to form rapport and a strong relationship with the child. And one of the ways of doing that is finding out what the child's interests are. So, for example, you may have a little boy who doesn't like to read, but he's very interested in sports, whether it be basketball, baseball, whatever. Then, of course, the sports page is a wonderful place to start, or perhaps baseball cards. Another child may be very interested in making things, and so then if that child has an opportunity to read the instructions and follow diagrams of how to make paper airplanes, or perhaps how to cook brownies or Rice Krispie treats, actually using what the child is interested in as a means of engaging them in reading has been very successful for us. And then being able to write about those experiences extends that even further.
Thank you very much. We'd like to get a lot more questions in, so let me turn to our audience again.
Hello. With summer coming, are there any suggestions on how to incorporate a summer meals program with tutoring in a low-income community?
I can take that one. Okay. The Title I schools are very often identified as feeding locations for children who are qualified for free and reduced meals during the school year. What we've done at Bell is we've formed partnerships with school systems, and we said, let us run your summer learning program. And so the school, through Title I dollars, makes breakfast and lunch available. But then the students get academics in the morning, enrichment in the afternoon, field trips, community service activities, guest speakers, and so they get two very healthy meals every day. And I should point out that research has been done recently on childhood obesity, and what they have found is that if students are not getting nutritious meals during the summer, that child obesity problem gets worse. And so I would say that looking for a summer learning program that is somehow linked into Title I free and reduced meals programs is a great opportunity to keep kids healthy, help combat childhood obesity, and give them an enriching summer learning opportunity.
We really do have a lot more questions for you, but we've run out of time. So I thank you for your very thoughtful answers, and I'd like you to ask you to do one more thing, and that's that I'd like each of you to leave us one final thought with the audience today. And can we start with you, Anne?
Yes, I think that it, again, as has been said before here, tutoring is not a negative experience. It's a positive one. And in fact, it can be one of the most powerful ways of enriching and engaging a student.
Thanks. Carol?
Yeah, you know, around the globe, countries other than the United States, students spend way more hours in the classroom than we do here. And it's showing the difference between how our children are prepared and how other countries are prepared. And so rather than thinking about tutoring as a negative, as a sign that your child has failed, I think we need to think about it as an opportunity to enrich these children and prepare them as well as we possibly can for this next century.
Absolutely. I'd just like to add that it's also cost effective. It's one of the most important investments we can make in our children's future and in our future as a nation. I started out by quoting the NAEP figures of 37% of our fourth graders unable to read at a basic level out of grade appropriate text. 20% of our nation's students are currently identified as learning disabled, and yet we have research to show that if you work through early identification and early intervention, providing small group and one-on-one tutoring right from the get-go, that you can reduce these figures to under 3%. And I think that this is a cost-saving, move. So I don't think we should let cost keep us back. In the long run, by investing in early intervention through tutoring, small group, and one-on-one, you will be saving millions and billions and trillions of dollars down the road. And reducing the number of children experiencing reading difficulties and increasing the success of students in terms of high school graduation and continued education for a lifetime.
Well said, all of you. Very powerful, and thank you very, very much.
Thanks, Julie.
And thank you for joining us. To view all segments of this webcast and for more information about how you can help the struggling readers in your life, please visit us at www.readingrockets.org. And while you're there, please let us know your thoughts. Click on Webcasts to find our online survey. Again, thank you for joining us.
Funding for the Reading Rockets webcast series is provided by the United States Department of Education, Office of Special Education Programs.